She was used to taking care of herself and others.
She grew up with a hard life. She was left alone a lot.
Her whole identity was a caretaker because that's who she had been conditioned to be.
Until she found a partner she could rely on.
She fell in love. He was definitely always there.
It was good and I was happy for her.
But their love story would be tragically cut short.
We found her in her bed.
She's naked, bruised, and bloody. She was very likely sexually assaulted.
This was just the worst thing ever to happen to her family.
Was it a random attack?
Where she lived, the crime rate was 4 times the national average.
Or was her killer fueled by rage?
He became obsessive.
She texted, "I'm gonna be going with an ex-coworker."
I knew it was him.
And even when the truth comes to light, will justice ever be served?
They had a star witness.
The trial was unbelievable. He killed her with his bare hands, like an animal.
February 1st, 2015, Buffalo, New York. It's Sunday afternoon in the Empire State's second largest city.
Generally, when people think of New York, they think of New York City. But Buffalo has a very different kind of vibe.
We're known as the city of good neighbors.
It has a small town feel. In a lot of situations, it feels like everybody knows each other.
But this seemingly typical afternoon comes with a sense of urgency for Rachel Johnson and her two daughters, who have just arrived at the home of her niece, 21-year-old Shaquila Costin.
Shaquila!
They were concerned because Shaquila hadn't shown up for work that day and she wasn't answering her phone.
Shaquila!
We automatically knew that something was wrong because Shaquila would never not show up for work. It would have to be an emergency for her to be a no-show.
But gaining access into Shaquila's home wouldn't be easy.
Her door was locked, so we couldn't open it.
They decided to take matters in their own hands.
Shaquila, are you in there?
See if the window's open.
We tried to break a window to get in.
They forced themselves into the house to check on their loved one.
I was looking around the house. It was spotless, like nothing never happened.
Shaquila, anyone here?
And as soon as they enter the bedroom, Shaquila's family members breathe a sigh of relief. It appears she's just slept in.
And I'm like, she in here asleep.
Girl, what you still doing sleep? You gonna be late for work.
But seconds later, the horrible truth is revealed.
Oh my God.
When I looked at her, I was in complete shock.
Oh, my God!
She had, like, blood just coiling out of her mouth and her nose.
I seen her, and I knew she was dead.
A lifelong resident of East Buffalo, Shaquila Costin knew what it meant to struggle and to overcome.
She had to fight her whole life, and that's just being honest, you know. It was a hard upbringing for her.
The neighborhood that we grew up in, it wasn't easy, it wasn't always safe.
She didn't really interfere with her father, and her mom wasn't around all the time.
She had to kind of grow up fast.
But Shaquila, or Kiki as her family called her, never let her hardships stop her from loving life.
Kiki was a joy. She was always smiling. She was always happy, always cracking jokes.
She was goofy. Her mom called her Monkey. So we all had crazy nicknames that we tortured each other with. So it was just like always a good time.
Shaquila was very silly. Shaquila thought everything was funny. She was literally like everybody's favorite to be around, to chill with, to laugh with, to hang with. Like, she just was so fun. She was real. She didn't care about how you felt. She spoke her opinion or something. She said what she said. She meant it. And you could just respect her for that because it was like she wasn't coming off nasty. She just always herself. Her house was like the party house for us, the house that we used to always want to go to all the time because, like I said, she just was like always, she's somebody that you will always want to be around.
Even if it's something awkward, she would turn it into a laugh, and she was just really just silly. We just would be laughing all day with her.
And while her parents may have been in and out of the picture, Shaquilla's extended family was always there for her.
She had a big family. You know how that is when you got big family. All your cousins are like siblings.
We live next door, down the street from each other, so we're always really cool and really tight. We was together every day from sun up to sundown.
They all would dress up the same way and take pictures together, just having fun, living life.
It was a lot of memories.
But Shaquilla was closer to one person than all the rest.
Her grandmother, like that was her go-to. That was her lady.
Her grandma was very helpful. She lived with her for a while. She held her down as much as she could, but whatever she can't do, Kiki had to do it herself.
That included looking after her baby brother.
As funny as she is, life of the party as she is, growing up, she had to take on the role of a caretaker for her family.
Ever since we were little, she had the responsibility of taking care of her younger brother. She took that responsibility as a woman, and even as a little girl, I respect her for that so much.
Part of that responsibility meant putting food on the table.
She didn't have that much help, so once she got old enough to get her actual real job, she started working.
She worked hard. She had to survive because she didn't have no one to take care of her. So she had to take care of herself, and she knew she had to work. So that's what she did.
Shaquilla was determined to provide for her family, no matter what.
She will always make sure that she had her own money so that she can get things that she wanted.
If Kiki could work 7 days a week, all day, every day, she would.
She was very dedicated at everything that she did, though. You give her a task, she was gonna get the job done. I respect her 100%.
But it wasn't all fun and games for Shaquilla.
She had goals. She wanted to live a better life that she was not exposed to as a little girl.
When she got old enough and graduated high school, she wanted to go to school for nursing.
And while Shaquilla saved up for nursing school, she got to work.
She started taking care of elderly people.
She was working in a nursing home.
A career in healthcare was the perfect fit for Shaquilla.
She liked to meet new people, working with them, helping them. That was, like, satisfying to her.
Ever since we were little, she had the responsibility of taking care of her younger brother.
When you kind of take on that caretaker role, it sticks with you. So it makes sense what she did career-wise.
She fell in love with that job. Her heart was so big that that was the profession that she should have been in. She was just a warm, caring person. And she would, you know, do anything for anybody.
In the spring of 2012, it turned out Shaquilla's big heart had room for even more.
When she was 19, she met a man named Raymond Smith.
She was walking to the store and Raymond approached her.
He was tall, handsome, you know, kind of fit the build of what she may be looking for.
I haven't seen you ride before.
Well, you must not have been looking.
There was almost like an instant connection.
Do you mind if I get your number?
Okay.
They exchanged numbers and it went from there.
It didn't take long for the couple to realize how much they had in common.
They connected based on their values.
Shaquilla's always been a hard worker and she was impressed that Raymond was also a hard worker.
Call me.
I will.
Here's somebody I don't have to take care of. He gets it. He's a worker like me. She was really smitten by that.
But even more important, was the way Raymond made her feel.
Shaquilla finally had someone there to take care of her, not the other way around.
He always was there for her. He treated her well.
He was a sweet guy.
The young couple wasted no time starting a life together.
Their relationship grew very quickly.
2 years into their relationship, Shakila gave birth to their son.
Raymond made her feel happy, comfortable. We're gonna do this family thing. I'm gonna have your back 50-50. I'm gonna do what I'm supposed to do as a dad.
Shakila was a very dedicated mom.
He was a great father.
They were happy.
Shakila was just becoming who she wanted to be.
But now, Shakila Costin has been found unresponsive in her home, with blood emerging from her nose and mouth.
Her cousins find Shakila lying on a bed, covered with sheets.
They immediately called 911.
I was just so in shock.
Sheriff's office, you gotta step outside with me, please.
When police arrive on the scene minutes later, they confirm that it's too late to save Shakila's life.
She's cold to the touch.
It was apparent that she's been there for some time.
It's also clear how she died.
Fluid coming from Shakila's nose and mouth was a clear sign of asphyxiation.
Somebody had strangled her to death.
Oh. 21-year-old Shakila Costin was building the life of her dreams with her boyfriend, Raymond Smith.
They had a young son together.
She was a personal care aide in the nursing field.
Her whole identity was a caretaker. That's what she'd love.
But on February 1st, 2015, Shakila's family finds her dead in her bedroom after she failed to report to work that day.
Can you guys step out with me, please?
I was just still very hysterical at that time.
It was a blur to me. I'm not gonna lie.
As officers lead Shakila's distraught family members away, detectives begin combing over the crime scene.
This is clearly foul play.
She had pink, bubbly fluid coming out of her nose, which is a sign of a strangulation. They found there to be petechia on the right and left eyes.
Petechia are broken blood vessels and really one of the most common signs of asphyxiation.
There were large marks around her neck that were consistent with somebody using their bare hands to choke her.
But Shakila's injuries didn't stop there.
She had been struck on the right eye. Her upper right cheek was bruised and swollen. She had scratches on her nose, lacerations on her neck.
She had a lot of defensive wounds, which tells us she fought hard to fend off her attacker.
And detectives suspect that Shakila's killer may have done more than just beat her.
Shakila Costin was on her bed, naked.
The fact that she was naked, investigators surmised that she was very likely sexually assaulted as well.
As horrific a discovery as that is, it could also provide investigators with a vital piece of evidence.
Anytime you have that kind of close physical contact between a killer and their victim, there could be some DNA left behind.
Other evidence suggests that Shakila's killer came prepared to commit this crime.
Hey, detectives. You might want to check this out.
On the floor by the front door was a latex glove.
The killer wore gloves. This was not a crime of passion. This was planned.
But did the killer originally just plan to rob Shakila?
While detectives were searching Shakila's apartment, they noticed her purse and cell phone were missing.
It's not a far-fetched theory, given where Shakila was living.
The area that Shakila lived in, the east side of Buffalo, the crime rate was 4 times the national average.
There's no shortage of crime and robberies in that neighborhood, particularly violent crimes.
But a more thorough examination of the scene appears to eliminate the robbery theory.
Aside from the person's phone, nothing else was missing. And on top of that, police really didn't see any sign of forced entry.
Nothing was really knocked over. There was no signs of damage to the walls or blood on the walls. It seemed to be confined to the bed only.
Officers would be walking around the perimeter. They'll walk around outside the home, seeing if there was forced entry, seeing if any windows were open, any doors were kicked in, They would look to see if any items were taken, drawers were shuffled through.
They didn't see any of that. And if you're a robber and you're going through the trouble of not just breaking into a place, but murdering the person inside, you're going to be taking more than just a little change purse and a cell phone. You're going to be going after the high dollar items.
Which leads the police to consider another possibility.
It really appeared that the person who had done this had some sort of relationship with Shaquila Costin.
Shaquila had a sheet laid over her body, which to us says the killer has some type of remorse, doesn't want to look at the body.
The average killer with no emotional attachment to the person, they wouldn't care to cover up.
But who would have wanted to kill Shaquila?
She was a nurse, a mom, and it didn't make sense that she was murdered this way.
Detectives began canvassing the community, asking neighbors if they'd seen anything out of the ordinary, just trying to get some information about what actually occurred the night before.
Most neighbors report seeing nothing suspicious.
Police were going door to door, and pretty much everyone they spoke to said they didn't know anything about Shaquila.
Shaquila's neighbors told homicide detectives that she just recently moved into her apartment and she kept mostly to herself. Neighbors did, on occasion, see Shaquila outside playing with her son.
She just seemed like a normal mom. No one had any idea who could be responsible for her killing.
But one woman tells the police that she heard something unusual the night before.
They spoke to the neighbor that was living upstairs from Shaquila, and she told them that she heard fighting in the middle of the night.
Did you hear what the fight was about?
No, but it sounded like a man and a woman arguing.
At the end of the fight, she heard a big thump and then nothing else.
It was a big boom as if somebody fell or something broke.
That would have been about 1 o'clock in the morning.
She didn't know what it was. She just went back to sleep.
Detectives, however, think they know exactly what the noise was.
Shaquila fought hard to fend off her attacker. She fought to live, she fought to save her life.
She seen some guy leaving the house at about 9:30 that morning. And after that, she didn't hear no more movement.
She didn't get a good look at him, but she was able to give detectives a basic description, a black male in his 20s or 30s.
It was someone that she's never seen before.
But she had no idea who he was.
She said she didn't pay no mind.
For the investigators, this could be her killer.
Okay, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
But even with the neighbor's tip, the detectives are no closer to identifying a suspect. Until a woman named Tracy Floyd comes forward.
Tracy was a good friend of Shaquila's, who also worked with her at the nursing home.
Thanks for coming in today, Tracy.
News of Shaquila's murder has spread to her circle of friends.
Tracy was the one who actually called Shaquila's family when she didn't show up for work. So when she heard that she had been killed, she definitely wanted to talk to detectives.
Tracy tells the police that she had plans to hang out with Shaquila the night before.
Shaquila didn't have her son that night, so they were going to spend the night together.
That's when Tracy reveals something alarming.
Well, she had just broken up with her boyfriend, so we were gonna have a girls' night.
Who's the boyfriend?
Raymond Smith. He's the father of her son.
The fact that Shaquila had just ended her relationship, that's raising a red flag.
Tracy says their girls' night never came to fruition.
She had got a message from Shaquila suddenly, canceling their plans.
But it had nothing to do with Raymond.
She said she was hooking up with some guy she used to work with.
This text alluded to the fact that she was going to be with this former coworker.
An hour later, Shaquila was dead.
Detectives in Buffalo, New York, have just learned that Shaquila Costin broke up with her boyfriend, Raymond Smith, shortly before she was killed. But according to her friend, Tracy Floyd, Shaquila had plans to meet up with a different man on the night she died.
She got a text message from Shaquila's phone stating that Shaquila was trying to hook up with some guy.
She said his name was Emmett Wilkins.
Emmett did work with Shaquila at her previous place of employment.
Assuming that they did meet up, that would have made Emmett Wilkins the last person to see Shaquila alive.
You can come with us.
Detectives thank Tracy for her time and move quickly to track down their new person of interest.
Emmett lived less than a mile from Shaquila.
Emmett agrees to meet detectives at the station for an interview, and he initially seems very upfront.
How long have you known each other?
A year, maybe a little longer.
He did confirm that him and Shaquila did work together at a medical office.
But when detectives push harder, Emmett doesn't budge.
Would you say you two had a romantic relationship?
No, nothing like that.
He said they had no type of relationship.
They talked at work, they texted occasionally. Sometimes they would go out for drinks with coworkers, but that was really it.
But detectives aren't convinced. Shaquila's text to Tracy specifically mentioned Emmett.
That's not what we heard.
Excuse me?
At that point, there was a shift in tone.
Emmett starts to get really defensive.
Am I being accused of something?
He refused to answer any more questions until he is told what's going on.
That's when the detectives break the news of Shaquila's murder.
We're really sorry to tell you this, but Shaquila's been killed.
Emmett seems surprised, upset. His reaction struck the police as genuine.
He has an even stronger reaction when police show him the text Shaquila sent Tracy the night before.
No, wait. No, I don't know what that's about.
And you didn't talk to Shaquila last night.
No, detective, that's what I'm telling you.
But Emmett has no way to account for his whereabouts at the time of the murder.
Emmett tells homicide detectives that he was at home all night.
Which prompts the investigators to take another approach.
Well, then we'd like to process your phone for evidence.
He agrees, and detectives decide to do a forensic analysis on the device. They're looking for deleted text messages, suspicious internet searches, really anything incriminating at all.
When the results come in, it looks like Emmett was telling the truth.
The forensic search of Emmett's phone did prove that Emmett and Shaquila has not spoken in months.
His GPS data also places him at the apartment the night of the murder, which all but rules him out as a suspect.
But that's not all the analysis reveals.
While they're looking through the messages between Emmett and Shaquila, the detectives notice that the language is very different from the text Shaquila had sent Tracy on the night she died.
Shaquila had very good grammar, and they realized that this text message had very poor grammar.
The text didn't seem to be in the style of Shaquila Costin. There were spelling errors, grammatical errors.
If Shaquila didn't send the message, who did?
It appears that a ruse was being perpetrated.
Whoever did this to Shaquila obviously had her phone.
So now the question is, who sent that text?
Detectives know from speaking with Tracy that Shaquila recently broke up with her boyfriend, Raymond Smith. Could he have sought revenge against her?
It all became very, very suspicious.
But before they speak with Raymond, detectives are hoping Shaquila's family can provide more insight into the couple's relationship.
After they found the body, the family was just really too upset to speak to detectives. But the next day, they agreed and they went down to the station.
When we went down to the precinct for our interviews, it was just hard. This was very hard on my family. We could not believe that this has happened.
It was so overwhelming at that time.
We just cried and we cried and cried.
We're so sorry.
Detectives showed them the texts that were sent from Shaquila's phone on the night she died. There were certain phrases and idiosyncrasies in the messages they wanted to see if the family recognized.
Does this writing look familiar to you?
It kind of does.
They said that's got to be Raymond Smith.
I knew it was him.
It was just strictly our eyes on Raymond.
In speaking with Shaquila Costin's family, detectives are becoming more and more certain that her ex-boyfriend, Raymond Smith, is behind her murder.
They were together for several years, but recently they had parted ways.
The family members believe that Raymond Smith had something to do with it.
According to Shaquila's loved ones, the couple's relationship had started out strong.
I mean, at first we really liked Raymond.
I thought he was a great guy. Raymond turned out to be a pretty good father.
He was there for his son, you know, like walking to the store miles and miles away to get Pampers.
But over time, Shaquila's family started to notice a change in her.
We're big on family, so we will always want to come get her or call her for her to come hang. But Kiki started getting a little distant.
She just wasn't her fun-loving self anymore.
When Shaquila's family confronted her about it, she didn't hold back.
Shaquila had confided in some of her loved ones that Raymond was acting strange.
Once she gave birth to her son, things kind of took a turn. Raymond was different, darker, more controlling.
He didn't like her going anywhere, doing anything with anybody.
He wanted to know her every move, what time she leaving, what time she coming back.
He was very controlling and, you know, he did not want her to go anywhere. He had a jealous streak in him, and he may have thought that she was seeing someone else, but she wasn't.
While Shaquila wasn't happy with the situation, she initially wasn't ready to end her relationship.
She really loved him, and that's still her son's father.
I would imagine there was a period of just shock. Because anybody can say, well, just leave. But it's difficult because you kind of question yourself. Am I crazy? How did I miss this? Maybe it's a one-time thing.
She just wanted to blow over. That's how she was.
But she wanted to start coming out and being around family.
But Shaquila's loved ones urged her to walk away from the relationship once and for all.
We told her to leave him.
Yeah, we told her it just wasn't worth it.
Our family started speaking up more and telling her, like, she's not alone, like, you don't have to deal with that.
And eventually, Shaquila heeded her family's advice.
We were all so relieved when she finally left him.
It was her fear of him that I believe made her break up with him.
After Shaquila moved out of the house, she decided not to let Raymond know where she lived for her own safety.
But since they shared a child, the couple still had to see one another from time to time.
After Raymond and Shaquila separated, they did decide to co-parent their child together, but tensions were high between them.
Shaquila would always be the one to drop off or pick up her son, so Raymond couldn't figure out where she lived.
Although her family isn't sure how Raymond found Shaquila, they're convinced he killed her.
Shaquila was very loved, very well liked. There was one person who she had conflict with, and that was Raymond.
Okay. She told me, like, if anything ever happened to me, just know he did it.
We knew that he had something to do with it. It wasn't no, okay, maybe, no. It was just strictly our eyes on Raymond.
After concluding their interview with Shaquila's family, detectives immediately set out to speak with Raymond.
Homicide detectives called Raymond Smith down to headquarters to be questioned.
At first glance, he doesn't strike them as a cold-blooded killer.
He seemed really inconsolable.
He said that Shaquila was the love of his life.
Still, Raymond admits that his relationship with Shaquila wasn't perfect.
It was hot and cold, you know?
He said they would get into arguments and things would get heated, but it was only because they cared so much for each other.
These fights, did they ever get physical?
Of course not.
Raymond told homicide detectives that he would never hurt Shaquila.
Raymond insists there's no way he could have been at Shaquila's home on the night of the murder.
He denied knowing where Shaquila Costin lived, hadn't been with her in a while, and had not had any relations with her.
But investigators aren't going to take Raymond at his word.
The police obtained consent for a DNA buccal swab from Raymond Smith.
And despite Raymond's cooperation, investigators still have reason to be suspicious.
While homicide detectives were interviewing Raymond, they noticed there were scratches on Raymond's neck.
Raymond, how'd you get those?
And he said, well, I'd been attacked. I'd been jumped over some marijuana like the day before.
Homicide detectives don't believe the story.
We're gonna go run this and we'll be right back.
But it's what Raymond does next that really sets off alarm bells.
The detectives left the interview room to submit that DNA swab for testing. While they were gone, there was an officer monitoring the CCTV camera.
And what the footage shows stuns the investigators.
This particular interview room had foam backing to improve sound quality. You could see Raymond Smith reaching under the foam backing.
Raymond ended up putting a change purse inside the wall.
It was like, why are you trying to hide it?
Police investigating the murder of 21-year-old Shaquila Costin have zeroed in on her ex-boyfriend, Raymond Smith, as their prime suspect.
We already had a very strong gut feeling that it was Raymond who would have done this to her.
Now, homicide detectives have spotted Raymond doing something suspicious during a break in his interview.
Raymond takes what appears to be a small coin purse out of his pocket and place it behind the foam wall.
He didn't realize that officers were still monitoring him.
The detectives immediately confront Raymond.
What's going on in here?
Nothing. What are you doing there? Bring it here.
The detectives asked Raymond if he had placed something underneath the foam backing, and initially he denied it.
But eventually, Raymond is forced to hand over the purse.
The detective asks him, why did you lie about this?
Raymond is ready with an explanation.
I stole it. From who?
My granny.
He said he thought that they would place him under arrest for stealing something for his grandmother.
We're going to keep it here for now. Let's go.
Investigators suspect that the purse actually belongs to Shaquila, but they're forced to let Raymond go until they can prove it.
They didn't know what Shaquila's purse looked like, so they didn't know if he was telling the truth or not.
There was still more investigation needed to be conducted.
Unfortunately for detectives, there's no identifying information inside the purse.
They were going to set up a time for the family to come in to look at the purse and to determine if it belonged to Shaquila.
But before they get the chance to follow up with Shaquila's loved ones, a new witness walks into the Buffalo police station.
Sherry Brown was a former co-worker and a close friend of Shaquila's. She had just moved to Rochester a few months earlier, but when she heard about the murder, she knew she needed to tell detectives about Raymond.
Sherry said that Raymond had been abusing Shaquila.
She stated to homicide detectives that it became physical, mental and emotional, but it became physical.
Shaquila confided things in Sherry that she wouldn't tell her own family.
Kiki was never going to tell us the bad parts.
Shaquila endured abuse for about a year. And so after a while, it's too much. I need to talk to somebody. I need to make sense of this.
Sherry says that what her friend was experiencing wasn't normal by any means.
For anyone suffering with domestic violence, trust your intuition. There's a tendency to idealize, forgive, explain away. Trust your intuition. It's there to guide you, to keep you safe. It's the most honest part of us. Trust it. You don't have to wait until a situation becomes violent or aggressive. Pay attention to the little signs, the intense insecurity, people who won't admit to wrong. Because people who justify everything, who are deeply insecure, who don't listen to what you have to say, those are usually signs that it can get a lot worse.
He was awful to her. The things she told me kept me up at night.
He would do things like break into her home, and he'd be in there when she gets home.
Day by day, things would get worse and worse. She used to sleep with a knife by her bed.
One detail from Sherry's story strikes the detectives as particularly significant.
She said, he'll take a shirt and then just sit there and choke me. And she never said that he used to, you know, punch her, put his hands on her. It was always choking her.
That would appear to line up with the murderer's MO.
A few months earlier, Sherry says she witnessed Raymond's abuse firsthand.
Shaquila and Raymond got into an argument earlier in the day before she went to work, and she was afraid to go back home. So the friend said, okay, I'll walk in with you, you know, to make sure everything's okay.
But everything wasn't okay.
When Shaquila and her friend arrived, Raymond was unexpectedly there.
What are you doing here?
I can't see the mother of my child.
No, you need to get...
He then grabbed Shaquila.
Her friend saw Raymond choking her and slapping her.
It was horrible to watch.
Next, Raymond turned his attention to Sherry.
Get out!
Raymond began ordering her friend out of the house.
I didn't want to leave Shaquila, but I didn't know what to do.
She ran to her car, locked the door, and called 911.
If they hadn't shown up, I don't know what would have happened.
At the time, Raymond was arrested and charged with domestic assault. But now Sherry believes he returned to finish the job.
Her friend was convinced that Raymond killed Shaquila.
He had gotten out of jail early January, and she was murdered February 1st.
All signs pointed to Raymond.
I have one question for you.
And when detectives show Sherry the purse Raymond had tried to hide, their suspicions are confirmed.
Do you recognize this purse?
She immediately identifies that purse as Shaquila's purse.
The fact that Raymond had that purse places him at the crime scene.
They were ready to arrest him.
But there's one problem.
The police couldn't find him.
He was on the run.
Police in Buffalo, New York are confident in their theory that Raymond Smith is responsible for the murder of his ex-girlfriend, Shaquila Costin.
There was a history of domestic violence between Shaquila Costin and Raymond Smith.
Police had caught Raymond red-handed, trying to conceal evidence.
Homicide detectives issue a warrant for Raymond's arrest.
But before police can place Raymond under arrest, they'll have to find him.
Buffalo police fanned out across the city in search of Raymond.
He wasn't going to work because they went to his job trying to find him. They went to his house trying to find him.
He went missing.
They determined that he's on a run.
Police were reaching out to all his close friends and family, trying to figure out where he could be.
As the search continues, investigators' case against Raymond grows even stronger.
The detectives received all the results from the forensic testing.
The skin under Shaquila's fingernails was a DNA match to Raymond. There also was a rape kit done on Shaquila.
It tested positive for the presence of semen, and Raymond was the source of that genetic material.
For Shaquila's loved ones, only one thing matters now, and that's bringing Raymond to justice.
We were just so angry with anyone who had any connection to him.
It just was a cold feeling. Every time I get cold, I just think about that time.
But 10 days into the manhunt, police finally get the lead they've been waiting for.
Homicide.
Detectives got word that Shaquila's phone was being used.
Since the phone had never been found, presumably it was still in Raymond's possession.
Police tracked the signal to a neighborhood in Northwest Buffalo.
They narrowed down their search to an address, and that's where they found Raymond. He was taken into custody.
There, detectives lay out the evidence against him.
Homicide detectives show Raymond the order of protection that Shaquila filed against him back in 2015. They show him the lab reports from her rape kit. They show him the DNA match that they got from under her fingernails, the evidence from pinging the phone to the address on Riverside. Homicide detectives also informed Raymond of the statements made against him by family and friends.
But he refuses to talk.
Raymond decides he no longer wants to cooperate with homicide detectives and requests a lawyer.
Raymond refuses to speak with detectives, but at this point, they don't need his confession.
He was charged with first-degree murder.
News of the arrest comes as a relief for Shaquila's family.
I said, thank you God that they have him.
Once they told us that they finally found him and got him, I was happy, I was.
It was a big relief to know that he was not on the streets anymore.
And in March of 2017, more than 2 years after Shaquila's murder, Raymond goes on trial.
They basically made Raymond out to be a jealous ex.
After Shaquila ended things with Raymond, he was filled with anger.
For somebody like Raymond, that's a threat. It's a threat to my ego, and you can't leave. Because if you leave, then I have to face the fact that I was rejected.
It's insecurity. He couldn't handle Shaquila telling him no.
I'd rather deal with the guilt and shame of being a murderer than deal with the reality of having to look in the mirror. I don't want what happened to confirm that I'm not good enough. So if I'm gonna suffer loss, I wanna do it on my terms. So I'll kill you, because then that way it's still ego, it's still control. I made this happen.
Prosecutors assert that around 1 a.m. on the night of the murder, Raymond's rage drove him to confront Shaquila.
Like, still to this day, we don't know how he even found out where she lived at. We don't know if he scared her and she just let him in, or was he already in the house because he was known for breaking in houses.
What are you doing here?
Come on, baby, you know I can't see you.
You need to leave.
No, baby, what are you talking about?
I'm gonna call the police.
She may have been sexually assaulted at that point, in addition to being beaten.
He continued beating on her.
Then, his hands closed around her throat.
There was an established pattern of Raymond choking Shaquila, but this time, it went too far.
Sorry. He choked her to death. He killed her with his bare hands like an animal.
Once Shaquila was dead, Raymond tried to cover his tracks.
He had her phone and was actually texting for friends and said, you know, hey, I'm at this boy's house.
You can see the wheels turning in what he's trying to do at that point, trying to set up somebody else.
As far as Raymond's defense is concerned, Shaquila was killed by somebody else.
The defense strategy was on casting doubt on the credibility of the witnesses.
They concede that Raymond and Shaquila had sex that night, but they say that doesn't make him a killer.
But then, at the 11th hour, a surprise witness comes forward.
We had received information from the defendant's brother that he wanted to cooperate.
It was really shocking to learn that Raymond's younger brother was willing to testify against him.
He had stated that he had been in the house when Raymond returned with bloody clothes.
Hey, what's going on?
Raymond had admitted to him that he had killed Shaquila.
She's gone. I strangled her.
What?
It was haunting the brother.
The proof of the case went in extremely well. The proof of the phone messages, the Facebook messages, the scratches to the face, the purse went in there. So the proof was going in extremely well. That, in addition to the already overwhelming evidence, I believe that the defense at that point were then trying to minimize however much they can. We were ready to call him.
In the end, though, prosecutors won't have to.
The court took a recess, and at that time, Raymond said he wanted to take a plea deal.
With his brother's testimony, he really had no chance. That testimony would have damned him.
The defense decided to cut their losses.
In exchange for his confession, Raymond is allowed to plead guilty to the lesser charge of second-degree murder.
We all was relieved once he pled guilty because we knew he did it.
At his sentencing hearing, Raymond gets the chance to speak directly to Shaquila's loved ones.
Raymond got up there and tried to tell the family that he was sorry, but his apology fell on deaf ears.
It was not sincere. I believe Raymond was only sorry that he got caught.
Raymond pled guilty because his brother was gonna tell what he knew, because he seen him trying to destroy some of the evidence.
The court doesn't show Raymond any sympathy either.
Ultimately, the defendant got 24 years to life, which is 1 year off the maximum.
While seeing Raymond behind bars is a victory, Shaquila's family will never recover from the wounds he caused them.
We will never be the same, no matter how many years it is. I still feel anger. It impacted me very deep.
Shaquila loved life. She wanted to live. What he did to her is so heartbreaking, and she didn't deserve it.
21 years old is very young. She didn't even have time to live for herself. She had so many things that she wanted to accomplish.
I wish she was here. We all wish she was here.
We will never be the same, no matter how many years it is. It's so many nights where I cry just calling out to her because I miss her so much. I just hope that it wasn't so bad when she passed away. I wish things were different. I just wish things were different. I wish that never happened to my family because it caused great pain to us.
But there's one person who misses Shaquila more than anyone else.
Our grandmother is taking care of her son, and he is in very good hands, but you know, I just feel really bad for my little cousin. He is such a sweet kid, and I know that Shaquila is proud.